talk about basketball. What do you think? Who in here can spin the ball on their finger? Anyone? Really? Really? Let me pick someone to spin the ball on their finger. Carrie, come on up. Carrie, come on up. Carrie Johnson! Carrie Johnson is here. Carrie, how are you doing?
Great. How are you?
This is great to see you.
Good to see you.
Carrie is an awesome, awesome young woman. She's been a part of our church for over 20 years. She is the better half of Pastor Mike Johnson. And that was her lovely daughter during the welcome. And I don't want to embarrass anybody, her boyfriend.
No.
Okay, anyway, Carrie, so you've never really spun the ball on your finger before. Well, here's something I used to do at basketball camp back in the day. I really enjoyed doing this. I'm going to spin this, and I'm going to teach Carrie how to spin the ball on her finger. What do you say? All right, Carrie, here we go. All right. This might not be easy, but you can do it. Okay, point your finger just like this. There we go! Thank you, Carrie. Carrie Johnson! How many people in here know how to shoot a layup? How many people have never heard of a layup before? A few. A layup is a basic shot, and I'm going to talk about that today. I'm going to talk to you about a layup. I want to teach you how to shoot a layup. A layup is a very easy shot on one hand. It's also a foundational shot. If you can shoot a layup, you can do a lot of stuff offensively when it comes to basketball. Years ago, my father taught me how to shoot a layup. So when you shoot a layup, you have to have some coordination. You have to have some footwork. You have to have some timing. Basically, if you're right-handed, and most of us are right-handed, if you're left-handed, you're southpaw, the same thing happens on the left side, but I'm going to teach you from the right side how to shoot a proper layup. It's shocking. In fact, it's astounding because a lot of people don't know how to shoot a layup, even college basketball players. Now and then I'll see them, they don't have the correct form. Let me show you how to do this because I used to do a lot of basketball camps and I've talked to a lot of people about it and I've shot a lot of layups in my life, especially at Florida State. I led the country in scoring, warm-ups scoring, hashtag shooting layups. Anyway, you shoot a layup like this. You take a dribble. Let's just start right here for demonstrative purposes. You take a dribble, okay. Then you take a step. So you want to lift the leg that you're favoring, or that is your good hand. So I'm right-handed, and pretend like a string is from my right side all the way down to my leg. I go up and shoot the ball. Thank you. When you're shooting a layup, you have to concentrate on the white square. See the white square up there? So if I hit the square, being on the right side, on the right edge, it'll pretty much go in every time. If I'm on the left side, for those, who in here, if you're a southpaw, left-handed, lift your hand. Yeah, the most creative people are left-handed. That's true, true. So the left side, same thing. A layup, though, is something that is fundamental. So you're playing basketball, and you have a shot for a wide-open layup, you just simply take it and score. It's a layup. Footwork, follow through. One of the big mistakes people make, and this even happens again when you watch television, when you shoot a layup, too many people put their hand, I'm getting a little bit technical, under the ball. Now, obviously, there are times when you can put your hand under the ball and shoot a layup, you know, or a scoop shot or whatever. But you want to have your hand behind the basketball when you shoot a layup. Why? Rarely do you have a wide open layup. Now and then you will. Usually you have someone defending you, an opponent. So when you have your hand behind the ball, if the opponent puts his or her hand in your face, maybe they bump you a little bit, you can reset the ball, see, and still get a shot off. If you do this and they try to block it, I mean, you're stuck in no man's land. Are you feeling me? Did you learn something today? I doubt seriously when you were driving to church, you said, man, I need to really work on my layup skills. Hopefully, Ed is going to teach me about shooting a layup. I kind of feel like I'm at basketball camp. I've done so many basketball camps. I love basketball camps. Basketball is a game, too, that you play on your fingertips. You don't, like, vice grip the ball. You don't use your palm really at all when you play basketball. If you go outside and play, your palm should never be dirty. Only your fingertips. Basketball is a game we play with our fingertips. After Thanksgiving, I was, of course, in Houston with my family. My mother's been sick for the last several weeks, and we had a great meal. And after the meal, we went into Dad's backyard and played a game of horse. Dad is 80 years old. He looks like he's 40. And someone filmed a little bit of us playing horse, and look at the layup that he shot.
Do it.
Yeah, there he goes. Watch it.
Yes!
Oh, yeah. Now that, that's my brother. That, it was a difficult shot because Dad shot a layup to try to put me out of the game. Of course, I won. Hashtag humbled. Dad was shooting a layup back here. So here's the great thing about a layup. Once you learn how to do it, if you see great players like Steph Curry, LeBron James, others, they many times will shoot a layup type shot way out here. Everything you learn about a layup, you can build upon it. I'm here to tell you that our great God is a God of the layup. I was shocked, and I began to research this a while back, how many times the phrase layup is used in Scripture. I thought to myself, you gotta be kidding. God loves basketball. Layup, layup all the time. Layup, 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 layup. A layup is foundational. A layup takes coordination. A layup takes concentration. A layup takes consistency. You've got to do it so much, it's second nature. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, the Apostle Paul instructed Timothy to write a word to those who are rich, those who are wealthy. And I love what the text says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17. You can see it, and I'll read it. Command those. This is not like a suggestion. It's not like, oh, we can discuss this, or let me give you my opinion on the matter. Who cares? This is what God says. Command those, I like those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant. Isn't it true that we call the rich people those? Yeah, those. The one percenters, the jet setters, the high flyers, the high rollers, the A-listers. And we use phrases like, must be nice, someday, lucky, wow. And social media exacerbates this. Social media, of course, is a ESPN highlight reel of stuff that's not real. If you think that's real on social media, it's not. I'm guilty of it too. Sometimes I'll do 4 or 5 videos until I get the right video to post that looks the best. It's not real. That's not what I do or you do all the time. It's funny and fun. Don't take it too seriously. However, if you look and if you read too much into social media, and I can sometimes, I say to myself, wow, they've got it made. Wow, look at their life. Look where they travel. Look what they do. Competition, envy. I have been having some problems recently I wanted to kind of reveal because this is the stage and I thought I would talk about some of these problems. You know, I put my car in reverse yesterday, And there were raindrops on my camera as I put the car in reverse. That was a terrible, terrible problem. Raindrops on that backup camera. And then it took my car over a minute to sync up with Bluetooth. That was horrible. A couple of weeks ago, I was in an airport and I had to wait over an hour for a flight. 1 hour. Terrible. In my second fridge, I walked in the other day, opened it, and it was packed with stuff. Horrible, terrible problems. Sprinkler system wasn't working right a while back, and patch in the yard was kind of brown. I've got some serious problems. I need an upgrade on my phone, too. That's a problem. Just my phone's overrated. You see what I described to you? First world problems, right? Problems of someone who is rich, because we discovered that pretty much everyone is rich. We read this text last week, and I talked about rich people, and you thought I was talking about the one percenters, but then we found out most of us are the one percenters, because the top income worldwide globally is $32,400. I said that, and a lot of people didn't believe it. And I have numerous sources. You can check it out on the World Wide Web. $32,400. Top 1%. If you make more than that annually, you're in the top 1% of the wealthiest people in the world. So let's say it. Let's just make a declaration. Call me wealthy. 1, 2, 3, let's say it. Call me wealthy. Doesn't sound, you're not saying that with very much conviction. 1, 2, 3, call me wealthy. I'm wealthy, you're wealthy, based on a world economy. But here's the problem, we don't feel wealthy. There's this line, there's this nebulous line where someone can cross, and I guess when we cross that, we go, okay, call me wealthy. What is wealth anyway? I just am kind of pausing here, and I'm going to continue to read 1 Timothy 6, verse 17. Wealth is having more than enough to gratify normal needs. A camera on your car when you put it in reverse, hundreds of channels on the television, and you say there's nothing to watch. Walk into your closet. Oh, I don't have anything to wear. We're rich, okay? Rich is relative. I understand that. Rich is subjective. I dig that. Let's just own it. We are rich. Here's what I've discovered about wealthy people. And when I said this last week, it was very controversial, but correct. And listen to me about wealthy people. I know a number of wealthy people. So do you. Because remember, we're all wealthy. I mean, some here make less than $32,400 a year. I understand that. But most of us here are wealthy. I do know some who are like real high rollers, people who have a lot, and you probably know them too. Most of the people I know who are wealthy are great people. Let me say it again. They're good people, great people. But they're not great at being wealthy. Let me say that again. Most people I know who are rich, who have surplus, I like the word surplus. We think the surplus is for us, right? So most people I know who are rich aren't good at it. It's not that they're bad people. They're not good at being wealthy. Now, Ed, how can you say that? I mean, I don't believe that. Because the rich people, I mean, the real rich, you know, the uber wealthy, they have companies and corporations and charities and this and that. Again, let me say it. Great people, they do some great things. They're just not great at being wealthy. And here's why. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17 through 19. Again, I know most of you are wealthy, but let's say you become like uber rich. Here's how to be good at it. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is, so let's say it together, uncertain. That's a fact, which is so uncertain. but put their hope, there it is again, in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good. Okay, what does that mean? Well, we're going to find out. To be rich in good deeds. All right, I'm tracking. And to be generous. Okay. And willing to share. Well, okay, yeah, Ed, I'm a generous person. I'll sometimes, you know, pick up the check and, you know, I'll throw a bone in the offering plate. I've bought this table for this charity and you know, I'm always thinking about the other person. And you know, I'm generous. I really am. Okay. Good for you. Rah, rah, rah. That's good that you think that way. That's awesome. In this way, verse 19, there's the word. Say it. Lay up treasure for themselves there's the fundamentals, firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. Lay up, so I can, wow, as a rich guy, lay up for myself treasures in heaven, in the next life. Lisa is not a great basketball player. She's okay. When she was younger, she still can jump pretty good, but back in the day, she had some serious hops, and she didn't even know it. She just has not played a lot of basketball. She played for her church league team, though, when she was in high school. And don't tell Lisa this story because she's out of town. Well, she's watching this. She's in South Carolina with her mom. She shot at the wrong basket. Everybody died laughing. She was so excited. She got the ball, and she just turned, and she shot at the wrong basket. She missed it. But she shot at the wrong basket. Could it be that a lot of us who were rich, I'm talking to the one percenters, most of us here, could it be that we're shooting at the wrong basket? Could it be that we're laying up treasures for ourselves as opposed to laying up treasures for eternity? Laying up treasure for yourself, you're thinking about the here and now. You're thinking about the present world. Timothy comes up to these people in Ephesus. Obviously, some were heavy hitters. They were the upper crusters. And he goes, hey, here is a new concept. You can be rich toward God. You have the opportunity with the blessings of God to do what? To shoot a layup. To lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. You lay it up and you score. That's what it means to put the ball through the net. So I need to be generous. I need to be willing to share, a firm foundation. When I'm generous and willing to share, when I understand that I've been blessed to be a blessing, what happens? Everything in my life can be built off of that. I can show you how to shoot a layup. I can show you how to shoot a layup. And if we practice for a while, you would take that layup and build a lot of things off of that layup. The same is true when it comes to being generous, true generosity, and being willing to share. That's a foundational principle. And God says, I've shown you how to do a layup. You've got a wide open layup. It takes coordination, it takes concentration, and just shoot the layup. It's going to go through the net. Don't even think about it. Well, what does it mean to be generous? I'm a wine guy. Okay, generosity, willing to share. What does that mean? Malachi 3:10 tells us, bring the whole tithe. What is the word tithe? Tithe is 10%. The first 10% of everything you make and I make goes to the house. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. This is my house, right? Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open, are you ready for this? The floodgates of heaven, and pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room to store it. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse. One of the nicknames for a basketball is a dime. I mean, you got the dime. Drop the dime. You know, you're passing, drop the dime, dime, dime. Tithing. A dime on every dollar. It's very simple math. The layup is very simple to explain. I could even explain it to you. And you guys have not played basketball that much. A few of you have, but I doubt, seriously, a lot of you play basketball. So it's simple. It takes coordination. It takes concentration. I lay up at least 10%. And I love what the writer says. He doesn't say, give it. He doesn't say, it's yours. No, no. We bring it. We bring it. When you play basketball at a gymnasium, you play on the junior high level, high school level, college level, NBA, the team doesn't own the basketball. The organization that you play in owns the ball. God owns it all. And if you think you own it, you're not going to take anything with you when you die. I have an opportunity, don't I, to sync up my heart with my stuff. Last time I kind of did a diagram for you, and let me do this again because it helps me. You have God, then you have riches. God and riches. You have the slope, has moguls and everything. We can do a couple of trees and everything here. I'm not a big skier, but the slope of hope. You got you and me. Money coming into our lives. Over 2,500 verses about money in the Bible. Jesus talked more about money than he talked about heaven, than he talked about hell or prayer. Sometimes people go, oh, I can't believe I showed up, fellowship. Ed's talking about money again. Hey, I'm sorry, I'm just giving you what the Bible says. Don't get mad at me. If you want to get mad at God or get mad at Jesus. Jesus, though, tells us, and the scriptures tell us, the main competitor for your heart and mine is money. It's money. It all comes back to money. Money's not evil. The root of money is we either love it and it messes us up, or we understand it's been given to us by God and we can leverage it for greatness. Yet, the test of blessings, the test of this whole thing I'm talking about has to do with the word hope. We hope in God. We orbit our lives around God. We hope in Him, and that's hope. The more we get, though, we get heavy. The more you make, the more responsibility. It's the juxtaposition of we need to enjoy our blessings. Don't feel guilty. I mean, don't feel guilty if you drive a Bentley or a Benz or a rocket ship, for all I care. Don't be guilty about that as long as you are bringing the first to the house. God says we can enjoy the rest. So we got enjoyment. That's one part of the juxtaposition. And the other, we have this great responsibility. When we are paid, when we are blessed, we have a tendency, if we're not careful, to turn our skis down the slopes and ride the slope of hope. Hope migrates like a spawning salmon. Here's my salmon. And what happens is it migrates from God to riches. Then we find ourselves orbiting our lives, putting our hope in riches, which are so uncertain. Does that make sense to everybody? It's so interesting, and it's so true, because hope migrates. We slide down the slippery slope of hope. I was talking to a friend of mine I know through fishing, who's a former Olympic downhill skier, and he was telling me about going nearly 100 miles an hour. He goes, I would point my skis downhill and just let it go. When we're blessed, suddenly we can start worshiping the blessings and miss the blessor. Whoa, it's so fun. It's so awesome. It's so amazing. Look how fast I'm going. And the people that I know who are blessed, who are wealthy, it's most of us, and the more wealth we have, wealth equals options, options equal time, then we think, wow, I'll give a gift, I'll give, and we think because some gift has all these zeros behind it, that God is like, wow, unbelievable, look at all those zeros, whoa, what a transcendent check. We think that. Jesus was watching people participate in the offering one day. All the high rollers were throwing these big offerings into the offering plate. The plate was rattling. Whoa. Everybody was like, whoa, man, that was something. Man, whoa. And then a single woman put just a couple of mites, a couple of pennies in the plate. Jesus goes, hey, guys, talking to his posse, his boys, right? Hey, guys, that is the greatest offering. When it comes to God's economy, it's not the number of zeros. It's not. It's the percentage. It's proportional. It's purposeful. It's passionate. That's a whole sermon right there. I'll keep going. So what happens to us is we have more and more, the percentage goes down, we end up throwing just pocket change at God, and where your treasure is, that is where your heart is. And if I am a wealthy person, I can travel, I can go here and there and yonder. There's always something that gives me fast, temporary relief for the aches and pains of life. So you see the separation that rich people have from God and from his house. And that is what Timothy was driving at. Very, very serious stuff. Then, you know, Jesus talked one day about a bunch of barns. Have you ever played basketball on the side of a barn before? Have you ever like nailed an old rim up on the back of a barn and played? You didn't have any cement, you just had dirt. I've played in areas like that before. It's kind of fun. It's truly old school. Well, this one cat, he made all this money, and he made just money on crops. He had all these crops, and he said, you know what? My barns are too small. I'm going to tear the barns down, and I'm going to make bigger barns for all my stuff, because, you know, the extra is for me. And in Luke chapter 12, verse 19 and 21, here's what the guy said, this farmer. I'll say to myself, you've got plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy, drink and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what I prepared for yourself? So is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not, let's say it together, rich toward God. Again, this whole phraseology, this whole vibe, being rich toward God, rocked the entire community back in the day. I can be rich. You can be rich toward God. And then Jesus said, and I have quoted this already, but let me give you the address of this. Matthew chapter 6, skip down to verse 21, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. It's the layup. Could it be that you're shooting at the wrong basket? Could it be that you are are just holding the rock. That's also another name for a basketball, the rock. And could it be you're just holding on to that dime and you think this dime is mine and you're doing what you want to do with it? Well, God's saying, you've got an open layup. Yes, materialism will be there trying to nail you. Yes, greed will try to block your shot. Shoot a layup. It's wide open. And once we shoot the layup, once we have that muscle memory, that consistency, once we're bringing God's offering to the house, everything else is going to be built on that, and we will be absolutely unbelievable. Think about one thing before we go. Think about Christmas. Just for a second, we're all thinking about it. The manger, you could say, was God's offering plate. God gave his tithe. Jesus, first. The manger. Then, of course, Jesus crawled out of the crib, became a man. He voluntarily put his body on the cross. You could say the cross, an offering plate. Then he died. They took his body, put his body in the tomb, an offering plate. Couldn't keep him down. Rose again. And now you see the brilliance of God's economy. We have an opportunity to give an offering to God. When I opened up, I talked about Dad teaching me how to do a layup. I'm glad for that because it served me well. I was able to go pretty far in basketball. But more importantly, my Heavenly Father, your Heavenly Father, has taught you how to shoot a layup. And it will lay up treasures in heaven. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this time that we can talk about a layup. And I pray, God, if there's someone here and you've never given your life to Jesus, I just pray you would just say, Jesus, I give my life to you. I give you everything I am right now and everything I'll ever become. Maybe some others here need to say, you know what? I'm ready to lay up treasures in heaven. I'm tired of shooting at the wrong basket. I'm tired of being a ball hog. Today is your day. We thank you for this time. In Christ's name, amen. Okay, here's our homework. And here's the good thing about it. You don't have to participate in this, but we are going to give you an opportunity to do so. We have some hosts to come forward, and we're going to all receive a commitment card because at Fellowship, we want to give you an opportunity to do the greatest thing out there, which is to shoot a layup, to score, to put the ball through the net. We have commitment cards that we're handing out to everybody. Don't freak out. You don't have to fill this out. It's between you and God. However, we do want to give you an opportunity to fill this out. And it's basically the future is bright card because the future of Fellowship Church is bright. Every year, we have an end-of-year offering. And this year, our end-of-year offering, we have some amazing things happening. What's happening, you might be saying. Well, first of all, we are doing a giant retrofit in our preschool area. Our preschool, we've been in facilities that are modular buildings since we started this campus. We're going to move our preschool from the modular buildings at the top of the screen into our children's building. So now we'll have all the preschool, nursery, the children in one facility, so it makes it easier for us to access that. And that's gonna cost $1.5 million, which, you know, that's a lot of money, but as you know, our kids are the future. And we're always talking about, oh, I wanna help the kids, I wanna help the kids, I wanna leave a legacy, I wanna help the kids. Well, read the stats. If a child makes it past 12 years old without accepting Christ, it's a rarity that they ever become a follower of him. Kids are exposed to things these days I didn't know about when I was in college, and you're the same. So it's time that we step up and do that. Another thing we're doing is we're starting another campus. We're starting this campus in the Salina Prosper area. Yesterday, we had just kind of a soft launch of that, just with some of the volunteers. Over 150 volunteers already are up there. And we're meeting at the Light Farms Elementary School, and that ticket costs $250,000. We've already signed the documents, so it's a done deal. We've got the cash. We either bring it, we either lay it up or not. Also, too, we are looking at a tract of land, which will cost between $2 to $3 million. We're gonna try to buy that as soon as we can and then start building. So we are thrilled about that. Something else we're doing is we're doing a retrofit to our Fort Worth campus. We're doing some more things with our C3 Global Ministry, which helps people in Haiti, Guatemala, Nicaragua. We've served over 9 million meals. We have over 33 orphanages. So those are just a few of the things we're doing. So fill that out. And I want to give you just a little bit of time to fill it out. If you're online, fill it out. You're in Miami, fill it out. You're in Fort Worth, South Lake, fill it out. You're in Dallas, fill it out. East Texas, that's right, fill it out. You know, when someone scored back in the day a basket, sometimes a creative announcer would say, write it down. The scorekeeper, see, writes down when someone scores. So you want to lay up for yourself treasure in heaven? Write it down. How do you do that? I will bring blank as an end of year offering. Well, Ed, I don't know what I'm going to bring because our company, I think this year, I think we're, you know, going to have bonuses. Well, I don't know. I mean, just write what you think you can bring. If normally you get $5,000, which is a huge bonus, maybe you want to do $1,000, $2,000, I don't know. Or maybe, just maybe, it could be more. But again, it's about what? Percentage. Percentage is proportional. Everybody can do something. I don't care if you're a young person. We even teach and train our kids in the time of offering in our incredible student ministry led by Pastor Mike Johnson. Then, there's another blank. I will bring blank annually as my tithe. Well, that's 2017. Why am I going to challenge you to fill that out? Because that will help us plan and all of the different things we do at all of our different campuses over the next year. And figuring out a tithe is pretty simple. You make $1 million a year, that's, I thought I'd start there, 100,000. If you make 10,000 a year, that's what? Yeah, exactly. And that's laying up treasure for yourself. So it's you're just dropping the dime, right? Dropping the dime. So fill out your name, address, city, mobile phone, zip, vertical jump, how many points you averaged a game in high school, and we'll get back to you very soon. But fill those out, and we're going to have some folks to come by and collect those. Our host, Nell, will come by and collect those cards. Come on down. Host, thank you. Let's give it up for our host. Great aerobic activity, cardio. Right. And if you want to take this home and think about it, pray about it, you can, but just fill that out. It really, really helps us so very much. As you leave, as you exit, we have these real cool invites because we have so many Christmas services coming up, and most people will give God a shot during the Christmas holidays. Invite people, invite your friends. Now, you can come twice if you bring someone different the second time. So we've got invites. I mean, sometimes we'll even put food with the invites, like cookies. I mean, who wouldn't say no to this cookie? Or I made something, you might have seen this on my Instagram feed. I made something called You Crushed It Creative Cajun Trail Mix. My recipe. I like it really hot, really tangy, really spicy. I might give that out. Anyway, and we even have some posters. Now don't just take this poster and waste it. Put it on a telephone pole, bulletin board, coffee shop, whatever. Maybe tape it, like, and wear it to work. I don't know. This is also advertising what we're going to do. So that's what happens when you leave. At all of our campuses, we'll give you all of this gear. So let me throw it back to our campuses. We got Growth Track 401. And I tell you what, before I leave, I'm going to try to shoot a three-pointer. It's been a long time, but I'm going to try. And I don't know. I have one shot. Be careful. I don't want to hit anybody. Okay? Let me try it.